Thank you so much. I know there's a lot of great conversation going up, and after the presentation tonight, we'll return you to all of that, but to have your attention for a little bit. First off, I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. My name is Nick Giuliano. I'm the president of Advance Atlanta. Thank you for dealing with the traffic and the congestion coming up tonight. For those of you who are coming, we appreciate everybody coming out on a weeknight to be supportive of this. I want to explain very briefly what Advance Atlanta is, and then we can go ahead and turn things over to Senator Beach and get talking about things. Advance Atlanta is a 501c4 nonprofit that formed out of the result of the ARC's Millennials Advisory Committee. We are a group of Atlantans who vary in age and vary in geography across Metro Atlanta. Can everybody hear me if I just do this? I'll project if that's better. So we are a group of folks from across the metro area who believe that the best interests of the region lay in a better integrated regional transit system. For too long, our effectiveness as a region economically, in terms of quality of life, has been affected by the congestion. Go back. Is that better?
Yes.
We'll do that. We're getting feedback. We grew out of the ARC's Millennial Advisory Committee. We are a group of folks who are located throughout the region who are championing a regionally connected transit system. We're gathered here tonight to talk a little bit about a very exciting bill that's going to be in the Atlanta General, the Georgia General Assembly next week. Without further ado, I'm going to turn things over to Scott Haggard with the Atlanta Regional Commission. Thank you.
Thanks, Nick. I'm Scott Haggard. I'm the Government Affairs Manager for the Atlanta Regional Commission. We're proud to be part of this event. We kind of feel like we birthed the group Advance Atlanta, because like Nick said, they were part of our Millennial Advisory Panel. We threw open an application process and received about almost 400 applications from Millennials to participate in our Millennial Advisory Panel. And one of the teams that resulted from that came up with the Coalition to Advance Atlanta. So we're very proud of that fact. We're very excited to be here and to help out with your event tonight. And we're looking forward to working with Senator Beach on his proposal to advance transit in Atlanta. So thank you for putting this on. We're excited to be here. I'll turn it over to James Touchton now.
All right, I'll be quick right here. I want to thank y'all for coming out. I'm James Touchton, Government Affairs, the Council for Quality Growth. And what we are, we're a 501c6 organization. We represent about 300 companies in the metro region, advocating for good growth, good quality growth. We have different transportation, water initiatives, and economic development. So that's what we do. We are proud to sponsor tonight's event, and I just want to thank y'all for being out here. I'm really here to introduce Brandon. I got to give Brandon a lot of props. He's a board member of ours and a longtime board member and a great friend. But you can't ask for a better advocate for transportation, for what you want, you know, for what you need and want down at the state capitol outside of Brandon. I say he lives his values. There's one thing about Brandon Beach. When you ask Brandon what is his position on something, unlike some legislators, you're never going to have to wonder what is Brandon thinking, because Brandon will always tell you what he's thinking, and when he gets to the floor to vote on it, he's never going to change his vote. And that's one thing you've got to respect and admire, whether some folks disagree or agree. That's one of the biggest comments I can say, is his character and integrity. When he tells you something, he sticks with it and does it. So I just want to thank Brandon for being here. I mean, we're running him crazy, running him ragged right now. You know, we're in the legislative session, so I appreciate you, Brandon, taking your time to come out here, and you're the one they came to see, so thank you.
James, thank you for that kind introduction. Nick, thank you for what you're doing and leading this group. And I just want to thank everybody for coming, and you know what? Y'all are engaged, and that's important. And we need you to be engaged. And it's good to see young faces here. I know, they mentioned the Millennials. We do have a couple older folks here. We got our council member from Alpharetta, Mr. Jim Gilman. Thank you for being here, Jim. And we have the newest council member. He is a Millennial, Jason Binder. So Jason, thank you for being here. And then we've got my wife here, who's not a Millennial either, but glad to have you here. You look like you're a Millennial. But anyway, let me tell you a little bit about transportation. I've been involved in transportation. I was on the Greta board for 4 years, and I was on the GDOT board representing the 6th Congressional District for 7 years, and then I've been in the Senate for 4 years, and I'm on the Transportation Committee. I'm secretary of that committee. So I've been involved in transportation, and one of the things we did last year, we passed House Bill 170. It was a user fee to allow us to really, and the reason I supported and voted for it was it weaned us off the federal money. Because when you use a federal dollar, there are 22 different steps and strings attached to use that dollar. And I'll give you an example. I had a project. Y'all know where the Outlet Mall is in Cherokee County on 575? We built a new interchange, and it was $25 million. And so I had GDOT, I was the GDOT board member, I said, I want to track how much money is spent on actual construction and how much money is spent on environmental studies and, you know, all the bureaucracy and the studies and so on. Only 51 cents out of the dollar was spent on actual construction. The rest was spent on bureaucracy. And it didn't help or hurt the road, the interchange to get built. But I just pointed that out because when you use a federal dollar, there are a lot of rules and regulations involved. With this money that we're going to get from House Bill 170, it's $1 billion, we can get roads built faster and expedited. Another example of that is a road in my district up in Cherokee County, State Route 20 from 575 to Cumming. It was going to be using federal money, and it was going to have to do a look at a northern route, a southern route, the main route, and it was going to take 5 to 6 years. We then took that and put it on state dollars because of House Bill 170. That will expedite that project 4.5 to 5 years. So that's good for the taxpayers and good for the citizens. But one of the things that House Bill 170 allows us to do, it allows us to do a T-SPLOS for 5 years for road projects or transit projects, any kind of transportation projects. So I want to tell you what I'm doing. I'm dropping a bill Monday, the MARTA bill, and we're taking a half of the penny.
Sorry.
Who's that?
Alpharetta, just a little bit.
Okay. So what we're doing is we're flexing a half of that penny. So it's not a new tax. It's not a tax going over the cap. You can't do that. We're just taking the tax that was allowed in that, and we're going to take half of it and put it towards transit. And then the other half will be used for roads and bridges when the mayors and the county can come together with a project list and go to the voters with that. So again, we're flexing that penny. So you probably say, well, why don't you just leave it in 170? You can't, because 170 only allows you to have a SPLOS for 5 years. Transit projects take anywhere from 10, 12, sometimes 15 years to build because they're so massive. So what we're doing is we're flexing that half penny out of the 170 into the MARTA Act, and then we're going to have it for the duration of the MARTA Act. So that will generate about $4 billion, and then we will get federal matching funds of $4 billion to get $8 billion. That's, you're reading a lot about $8 billion. That's how we get to the $8 billion number. And then we're going to build three projects, and this money is going to go to construction, not operation and maintenance. We're going to build the line up 400, if the voters vote for it, up the Clifton Corridor to Emory and CDC, and then out I-20 to Stonecrest Mall. Now let me be very, very clear. Not only does it has to be voted on by the legislature to allow the county commission then to go to the voters. And then the voters have the ultimate decision. So if they decide they want to invest in transit, then that's what they'll do. If they don't, they'll vote it down. Very simple. I will just tell you that at my time when I was on the GDOT board, I used to always go to the transit committees at ARC. What they used to be called, TPC, Transit Planning Commission? Or
Transit Planning Board.
And so anyway, I would go to those meetings and I would get so frustrated because all we would do is talk about how we were going to have regional transit, who was going to be on the board, who was going to administer the money, and so on. So I kind of said to myself, if I ever get the opportunity to really look at regional transit, I'm going to do it. And so when I got elected to the Senate, I went to the Lieutenant Governor, Casey Cagle, and I said, Governor, I said, I want to do a study on regional transit, truly regional transit. So we did a study committee, and that's what we do in between session. A lot of times we'll study an issue, and we were studying transit, regional transit. Well, I don't know if y'all saw it, maybe some of you did, but I decided to take a ride from Kennesaw State to Gwinnett Arena. It's 32 miles, and it took me 4 hours and 10 minutes. And I had a North Georgia student film me. But I got to tell you what I learned on that, folks. I learned something. It wasn't just that it was a fragmented system. I learned that I had to go to three different websites to plan my trip. I had to go to the CCT website, the MARTA website, and the Gwinnett website. I also had to pay with three different methods of payment, cash, breeze card, cash. So, you know, there's two type of riders. There's a lifeline rider that does not have an automobile that has to take transit, and they'll wait and do whatever they have to do. And then there's the lifestyle rider that has a car. If we're ever gonna attract the lifestyle riders, we will not do that if they have to go to three different websites, pay three different methods, and wait 30 minutes on a station. And really, I just also want to make perfectly clear, when I rode the COP system, it was great. It was clean, it was safe, got me where I wanted to go. Then I waited, I got on the MARTA system, same thing, clean, safe, got me where I wanted to go. And then the same with Gwinnett. So all the systems, when they by themselves were good, they just didn't communicate. There was no collaboration, communication, okay? So we really do need a regional transit system. We have not expanded MARTA in a long time. And I'm here to tell you, I used to serve on city council where those two council members serve, and I was elected back in 99, and I used to bash two entities. I used to bash Grady Hospital, and I used to bash MARTA. When's the last time you heard anybody bash Grady Hospital? They're doing well, they're making money. That's one of the most well-run public hospitals in the country now. Same with MARTA. Keith Parker has done an outstanding job changing the culture of MARTA. He's done a great job with cutting out the knucklehead behavior. He's trying produce stands in his stations. He's adding artwork to his stations. And he's committed in 18 months he'll have Wi-Fi in the tunnels and on all MARTA buses and trains, which is a big deal. So I will just tell you that I think we need to expand MARTA, and I'll tell you why. I'm going to put on my chamber hat. I'm CEO of the North Fulton Chamber of Commerce. I've been CEO of the chamber for now going on 14 years. And when I started at the chamber, we're in economic development. And I saw that when CEOs, they made the decision where the companies were going to relocate based on where they wanted to live. So if the CEO wanted to live on Windward Parkway or Golf Club of Georgia, they were going to live and bring their company to Windward. Vice versa, if they wanted to live in Sugarloaf, they would go to Gwinnett. Okay? You fast forward to today, that CEO is still making the decision of where to locate the company, but he's making that decision based on where the talent is. And I got to tell you, I saw it firsthand here. We lost 600 jobs in my district, Athena Healthcare. They left, and thank goodness they didn't go to Charlotte, but they went down to the Ponce Market. And there were 600 jobs that were right up here in North Fulton. And when we talked to the CEO, he said his talent lives down there on the Beltline and Virginia Highlands, and the traffic was getting so bad coming north as it is south, they just couldn't take it. So he had to make a decision. Does he want to get new talent or go where the talent is? And he made that decision. And if you look at the last big announcements, State Farm, Mercedes-Benz, NCR, Pulte Homes, all of them had said transit is a key component on their decision. It wasn't the only component for their decision. But what we're seeing with these CEOs, it's a box that they need to check off for their employees to be able to offer transit. We have been so successful up here in this Georgia 400 corridor. I want to make sure that we continue to be successful. Listen, folks, even if we pass this bill, we won't have MARTA up here probably for 10, 12 years. It's going to take a while, 8 to 12 years to build it, okay? I won't even probably be around. I may be at the beach or at the lake. I'm not sure where I'm going to be. But I will not be in office, and I'm not doing this for me. I'm doing this for my kids and my grandkids. And I'll share an illustration. Mark Burkhalter is a dear friend of mine. He was the Speaker of the House, Speaker Pro Tem, and then Speaker of the House. He went to Milton High School and he graduated in 1979. He tells the story, he says, in 1978, when he was his junior and senior year of high school, they would go and hang out on Georgia 400 and not see a car for 3 hours. They would drink beer, well, I probably shouldn't say that, they would go out and hang out, all right? Because he probably shouldn't have been drinking. But I always tell him, I say, Mark, I can't believe that, I'm glad I didn't live in Alpharetta back then, because if that's all y'all had to do was hang out on the expressway, there must not have been a lot to do here. But he would go out there, and he said they wouldn't see a car for 3 hours. They actually filmed Smokey and the Bandit up here and didn't have to close the road down. Didn't cause any problems. Now, somebody had the vision to build Georgia 400. And thank God they did, because that's why our property values up here in North Fulton are what they are. And that's why we have 900 technology companies up the Georgia 400 corridor. It's because of the vision that someone had that did that. Same with Hartsfield, with Hartsfield-Jackson Airport. We wouldn't have to be the number one airport in the world if William Hartsfield wouldn't have made that investment. So I'm all about investing in transit, and I think it's the right thing to do. And I'll leave you with this last, and then we'll just open it up for questions. Before I was chairman of the Economic Development and Tourism Committee in the Senate, I was chairman of the Science and Technology Committee in the Senate. And so last year I went out to Google headquarters to learn more about Google and cybersecurity and the internet and so on. And one of the things I found out, Google's not just a search engine. They actually have come up with a contact lens that detects diabetes that's going to be manufactured right down the road here in Johns Creek, Georgia at Alcon. And it's really cool technology. But anyway, we learned a lot about what Google's up to and what they're doing and what their issues are. And at the end, the executives came in and talked to us. And they talked to us and they said they surveyed all their employees at Google headquarters under the age of 30, 15,000 of them on that campus. And they said the three things that really stuck out to me was 100% of them, this is their only phone. They do not have a landline. There's no landlines in their apartments, condos, or homes. 80% of them said they had no desire to own a home. Even if they could afford it, and they could because they were getting paid well, they want to be mobile and be able to leave and go to work at Microsoft in Seattle if they want to. They did not want home ownership. But the thing that really struck me, because I'm so addicted to my automobile, 50%, 7,500 of the 15,000 do not own a car. And so I asked one of the executives, I said, why don't they want to have a car? I love my car. They don't want the expense, the maintenance, the car note, the insurance, and they don't want to pay for parking. So they take transit into work, they Uber when they want to go to dinner, and then they rent something called a zip car, which I learned, I didn't know what that was at the time, but they rent a zip car. So the millennials are thinking different, and we need to make sure we're providing these opportunities for them to come and work in our area. And so that's why I'm bullish on transit. A lot of people say, well, why don't we just do bus rapid transit? And that could be an option. But I will tell you, that's not free either. Bus rapid transit is $1.4 billion. Now, heavy rail is $2.4 billion. It's another billion to come up 400. But we just have to let MARTA make those decisions and let the studies make those decisions. And the alternative analysis study that they did do, heavy rail was the preferred option. So with that, I just again want to thank you. The bill, like I said, all it does, it's a very simple bill. Some of those bills are 20, 30 pages. This is a 3.5, 4 page bill. Because basically all it does is say we're going to flex the half penny for transit projects, construction only, capital projects, and the county has to vote for it, and then the people have to vote for it, and we'll decide what we want to do. So I'm just giving the citizens the opportunity to vote for transit, and I think the polling shows that they are overwhelmingly want it. So with that, thank you again for being involved. Stay involved, and especially when I drop this bill, I'm gonna need your help. Stay involved, but you know, if you want to be part of the community, you got to be involved in the community. And we're lucky we've got this great community we live in, but it doesn't happen by accident. It happens because of involvement and leadership. So with that, I'll open it up for questions. Anybody have any questions? Thank you. Thanks for having me. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Legislation on Monday. So, what can people in this crowd do to help support that?
Well, just, you know, when you're on your, I'm not a blogger, so I don't know, but I mean, if you're on a blog or if you're on a social media, promote it because I'm going to need the help there, and we just need to get the word out. And here's what we're going to do is try to get the real information out there. There's a lot of misinformation out there that I'm going to raise taxes. I'm not raising taxes. I'm looking to flex a penny that's already there. I'm looking to take half of it for transit and then I'm looking to let the voters decide. What's wrong with that? So that's what I'm doing.
Hey, Senator, can I follow up
yes.
on that point real
quick? Yes.
So to your point of what can everybody in this room do and what can people in the community do, on our end from Advance Atlanta right now, if everybody has their cell phone and you take it out, you go to www.advanceatlanta.com and you can sign up on there to receive email updates from our listserv. So we're going to be following the development of this bill very closely. We're going to be putting out next week an advocacy letter to everybody on our email list asking for residents to sign up in support of this bill. And we'll keep you updated from that. We'll be looking to deliver that bill throughout this legislative process. Also, as we get closer towards crossover day, we'll organize a lobby day, and we're going to pair up folks with their legislators to be as supportive as possible. So if you have not already signed up for email updates at advanceatlanta.com, please do. And if you follow us on Facebook and Twitter as well, we're going to be very supportive. So you can engage and coordinate through us for part of that.
Well, thank you. Any other questions?
Right here.
Yes, sir.
I'm sure most everyone in here is aware of the 2040 plan, which shows light rail across 285. I haven't been able to, until last week, to see even the hint of any mass transit component to the new 285 revamp. Could you address that?
And I haven't seen it either. I have seen managed lanes from 75 to 85, mm-hmm. two additional lanes. Reversible lanes like they're doing on the north by northwest corridor 75. I have seen that, but those are going to be toll lanes. Yeah. And if you want to ride in them, you'll have to pay for them. If you don't, you just sit in the suit. But I have not seen anything on light rail. But there is some talk about doing some kind of transit from Braves Stadium to the perimeter and to trying to do something there. There's been talk of monorail, there's been talk of light rail. There's actually one of the things we studied. Up here in North Fulton, the chamber, we looked at doing gondolas down 400, which was kind of a unique deal, and it was very, it was a lot cheaper, kind of like the gondola you go up Stone Mountain on, seats about 60 people, and you get on it and go, and we looked at that, and you laugh. It made sense, except for one thing. It only went about 12 miles an hour, so it was too slow. It just didn't work from a speed standpoint. But anyway, I will get on that and look on that, but right now, I'll just tell you, the plans I've seen in the 10-year strategic plan that the governor just announced, it was all managed lanes. Okay?
Don't you agree that it's
I agree. Wrong? I agree.
It's very wrong.
Long
4 hours. 4 hours to the cross town.
Yeah, long overdue. I couldn't agree with you more. Yes. Yes.
Hey, Brandon, I have a question. So there's some opposition here in our whole thing.
Yes.
Some of the government levels. I'm curious as to what we need to do to curb that appetite.
You know, I think we just need to educate everybody, and I think we all need to get in the same room and talk. None of us, I mean, Jimmy and I disagree on this, but we don't make it personal. We disagree without being disagreeable, but that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. But the more I think I can educate Jim, I think I can maybe never get him on my side, but I think he can maybe understand why I'm doing it and understand that I'm just allowing the voters to have an option if they want to have transit. Listen, I'm a conservative guy, and I don't believe in raising taxes, but I do believe in this, if it's for some kind of social program or whatnot. But I do believe government exists to, number one, keep us safe. That's the most important thing. But number two, to invest in infrastructure. We can't go out and build a water sewer plant. We can't go out and build a transit facility. We can't go out and build a four-lane road for 5 miles. I mean, I don't have the wherewithal to do that. But collectively, we can do that. And we need to invest in our infrastructure. There's nothing wrong with putting dollars towards infrastructure. I'll give you an example. I fought hard for $25 million in the budget for that new technical college. They've already got almost 1,000 students. They open January 6th. Listen. I'm all for education and for, you know, making sure we have a trained workforce. You know, we had the president of Gwinnett Tech talk to us the other day about the new technical college here, and he said something that I never thought about. He said, if you drop right to the floor and had a heart attack, before you see a doctor, you're going to see 7 of our students, the EMS driver, the person that checks your blood pressure, the person that puts your IV in. You're going to see 7 Gwinnett, or not just Gwinnett Tech, but technical college, 2-year certified people before you even see the doctor that's going to save your life. So I'm all about investing in that kind of education. I didn't mean to get off on that, but I'm just saying government does need to invest in certain things, and infrastructure is one of them. Let me tell you what, folks, we are so behind. We are so behind on roads, bridges, and transit. We haven't had an investment in transit in 18 years. It's time we did. If we don't, we're not going to be able to keep up. And Dallas and Charlotte and everybody's going to put it to us. And we're the number one state in the country to do business. And that didn't happen by accident. It's leadership. We have a good tax structure here. And we foster business. But I can tell you there is a breaking point where people are just not gonna sit in a parking lot.
Brandon, I live in Alpharetta. Yes. I have to commute every day down 400. Yeah. And I don't take transit because by the time I get to North Springs, I already got the top part of my commute done.
Right.
And honestly, those people, I would love them to hop in the car with me every day and take that commute because honestly, it's getting old.
Yeah. And I will
you
tell you,
the same, you and I.
I agree. And I'll tell you, I think some of the people that are in opposition, to be quite honest with you, don't drive on 4400 very much. They live more than
that. Yes.
I do have a question, because yes. I was getting ready for taking office of city council, I did notice that the ARC had the North Fulton Comprehensive Traffic Plan, and I always say, plan. I'm a financial advisor, so I tell everybody plans are useless, planning is essential. So that being said, I thought they had a pretty good planning activity for mass for transit, starting off with the density's not there yet where we are in North Fulton, but it could get there.
Right.
Starting off with a bus rapid transit, showing again, make sure we get the right of ways going there, and then throughout time, moving that to a rail. You mentioned Charlotte and Dallas. I went to school in Dallas for my MBA. Those are both light rail areas, you know, somewhere closer to bus rapid transit. Why not go that option right now with our T-SPLOS? So having it seems like the mayors were getting ready to have a 75 cents to, and then a quarter to tomorrow.
Right.
Having that
0.75.
To starting off with that, and then in the 5 to 10 years time that you talked about with the heavy rail, move on towards that.
Well, don't disagree with you. Let me just say this, Councilman. This is going to be a very fluid process. I am going to drop the bill Monday. I did meet with Dick Anderson and Todd Long today with Fulton County, and met with them, and we had some great discussions. And things can change. But right now, what I'm dropping is a half a penny to allow the voters to flex in the 170 penny, not adding a new penny.
Is up to half a penny, or it could be within the range of a half a penny?
Well, right now, it's a half a penny. But again, it's fluid and we can change. But I want to know that these mayors are on board before I do that. I'm not going to negotiate from a position of weakness. So I want to make sure that they have a plan, too, on roads and bridges. Yes.
You just mentioned how you don't want to, go in with a point of weakness. I mean, what type of your strong points that you're going to try to sell this? Because I was telling you earlier, Charlotte has a blog now, like, don't become Atlanta.
Right.
They're gladly taking our jobs from us. And, there's been numerous companies tell Nathan Deal that they won't come here because of transit.
Correct.
So I'm just curious, what are your talking points that you're going
to
try to sell
this? Well, to that point, I can tell you that leadership is for investing for transit. Lieutenant Governor's talked about it for the last 6 months in his speeches. The Speaker of the House was on TV the other day and being interviewed talking about how he's for it. The Governor, let me tell you this. The Governor right now, when he's recruiting a company like Mercedes-Benz, Keith Parker's in the room selling MARTA, selling transit, and letting them know where the stations are and selling the system. So, to your point, leadership's behind this. And so we just got to get it through. But my selling points are that. I mean, that's one of my selling points.
Senator, could I also respond to the council member? Councilmember, I would just say that any of these investments you're talking about, whether it's bus rapid transit, light rail, or heavy rail, are 50 to 60 year investments. It doesn't matter what the technology is. So, whenever you're making this decision, you're not making it for the next 10 years or the next 15 years. You're making it for the next 40, 50, or 60 years. So I think when you decide what the technology is that you're going to put in the corridor, you should be considering those kinds of things.
Yeah. I completely agree with that entirely. I'm just within the frame of the T-SPLOS is 5 years.
Right.
You talk about 75 cents to 50 cents. You know what that is? That's Old Milton Parkway that y'all travel. That's 25 cents between us. We can complete that. And during that time, the
bus rapid transit, which was agreed upon by all the cities in North Fulton as the first stage towards transit. I agree with the transit needs to get accomplished. It's much needed. But we also got to make sure that we take care of those roads that are beyond the half a mile that the MARTA serves. So I agree with you there. But.
Well, you know, we just announced a comprehensive 10-year strategic transportation plan, the governor did.
Yep.
And it's next year we will put $1.7 billion this year, $1.8 billion of state funding, not counting the $1.5 billion of, or almost $2 billion of federal money. We're going to do what Florida does. What Florida does, they use their state money for capital projects, so you don't have to do all the strings that I talked about earlier. And then they use their federal money to cut the grass, resurface, maintenance, to where the strings attached to use that are not as stringent, if you will. So that's what we're going to do, and we're going to expedite projects, so I think you're going to see improvements on Old Milford. It's not going to happen tomorrow, but I think in the next few months you're going to see orange barrels. And let me tell you something, folks, when they break dirt on 285 and 400, it's going to be painful for about 3 years. Believe me, it's going to be painful, but I think the pain will be worth it when it's done. You're going to have basically a $1 billion new interchange with collector distributor roads that is going to, and nobody can argue 285 and 400 is probably one of the most dangerous and the worst interchanges, I think, in the region, and maybe in the southeast. So, yes, I'll take a couple more questions.
Oh.
Yes.
Senator Beach, Bob Crone from Tucker, obviously not in your jurisdiction.
Okay.
But very interested in transit. Do you think the proposal that DeKalb County is putting out for a 1% sales tax for roads is going to hinder any kind of similar bill in DeKalb?
Well, what we did, DeKalb came to me and said, we may not be ready this year, 2016, so we put a provision in the language that you can vote on it in 2016 or 2017. So even Fulton County can wait for 2017 if they want. There's two bites of the apple, okay? The other provision I want to tell you that's put in there just to make these councilmen comfortable. The private development around the stations will have to go through local jurisdictions. So I put that in the bill. I call it the David Belloc couple lines, but David convinced me. But we put that in the bill, okay? And that is good. I mean, we want to make sure we have quality development around those stations if they're able to get this voted on and get it passed. All right, next question. One more question. Yes, sir.
Might be a kind of hard question. I'm actually a Johns Creek resident myself. And
okay, then I've been we're done.
Yeah, I've been kind of against it for a while now, but I'm open to being educated on it. I actually grew up a large part of my life in Germany, where transportation is beautiful. You know, we have light rail lines, heavy rail lines everywhere. You can get wherever you need to go. This whole expansion keeps on talking about moving north on 400 and out I-20, and then the Emory line and everything.
Right.
My big concern is when I commute down 400, which takes forever, it takes me 45 to 50 minutes if I miss that window to get to North Springs.
Correct.
MARTA's not going where I needed to go. You guys keep on saying, let's be like these other cities. Well, those other cities have a spider web, right, lines. And you're just talking about going north and south.
I don't disagree with you, but I think what will happen is if we do this, I think you will see some east-west opportunities for transit, whether it's shuttle buses, whether the CIDs get involved in it. Sandy Springs talking about doing a monorail. One of the things Keith Parker's done too is when you get off the station, you hit Uber and they're there waiting for you. That's what he calls it, the Uber last mile. So if you need to go a mile or two away from the station, you can Uber. So I do agree with you, because you got to get to the station and you got to get to where you're going from the station. So we need to look at that. But I think that will come. I really do. I really think there'll be some bus systems within, the cities, if you will. So. And a lot of CIDs, you all know what a community improvement district is. It's a self-taxing business district that invests in infrastructure. A lot of CIDs, the Buckhead CID right now has those shuttle buses like you get at Park and Fly Plus, and they're always going around from business to business. So I think you'll see some of that.
Thank you.
But thank y'all. Again, Nick, thank you very much. I appreciate your leadership. Thank you for allowing me to speak. You know, just kind of follow this bill. The process, it's not easy to get a bill passed down there, which it shouldn't be because we're changing law. So let me just explain what's going to happen real quickly. I will drop the bill on Monday. The Lieutenant Governor will read it on Tuesday. So I put it in the hopper on Monday, it gets read Tuesday, and when it gets read Tuesday, it gets assigned to a committee. It will go to the Transportation Committee, which I'm a member of. It'll go to Transportation Committee, then we will hear it, and we will either just have a hearing or a hearing and a vote. If it's a hearing and a vote, it will then go to the Rules Committee, and then we will have a hearing at Rules and a vote. Then when it gets out of Rules, it'll go to the Senate floor, and then we need to have 29 votes to vote to pass it. And then when that happens, it goes to the House and goes through that same process. Goes through transportation, you know, gets read into the House, goes to the Transportation Committee, goes to the, gets assigned to Rules, and then to the House. And then there could be some agree disagrees, and it's, then we may have to have a conference committee. There's all kind of ways that this gets done. But I met yesterday with Jan Jones and Wendell Willard, and we are working together so that there aren't a lot of surprises. I want to let them know everything we're doing, so when it does come to the House, we can have as little disagreement as possible, hopefully, and get it in the front end. So that's good news. And so the process is going to take a while, but by getting a hearing on it by Thursday, we will really be light years ahead before day 30 approaches. Yes?
Do you know if there's going to be any type of legislation for transit in areas, I mean, that's not necessarily focusing on millennials who basically choose not to have a car, and as opposed right. to people in areas that can't afford to have a car. You know, the service workers that, you know, live, for instance, like, you know, in the unincorporated North Cross area that have to travel to other areas, you know, just to do service work, but they have no transportation. So right. is there anything in discussion about that?
Well, there is, you have Red Express that goes all over the region, and those are express buses. Cobb's doing their thing, and Gwinnett's doing their thing. I will tell you this, and I'll end on this. I honestly believe this. If we do pass this, and they know that Georgia 400 is going to have transit coming up to Windward, it's going to force Cobb and Gwinnett to make some tough decisions and say, if we don't get involved, we're going to get left behind. So I really believe that. And then we can then really start working on having a truly integrated regional transit system that's coordinated and communicates. And I'll say this, is transit gonna solve all our problems? No. But is it gonna help? Yes. And I'm a firm believer we can get these lifestyle riders if we do a couple things. One, we make it simple, convenient, clean, and most of all, safe. If we make it safe, people will ride it. And I think it'll be an option. So that's why I'm fighting for it. You know, I'm a Republican from the suburbs pushing transit, which is unusual. But I will tell you, I'm doing it because I think it's the right thing to do. Thank you all very much.
Thank you again, Senator Beach, for coming out tonight. Thank you to everybody who's come. Before we adjourn, can I have everybody on the board of Advance Atlanta raise their hands real fast? So if you have more questions about the organization and any questions about us or the bill's path forward, please find somebody with their hands raised, track them down, and talk to them. Again, if you have time, please do that. And lastly, please remember to close out your tabs. We've had a lot of people providing us with food and drinks tonight, so close out your tabs. Thank you so much.